Srijesara, good morning. Okay, Sarada, mute akana Sara. Okay. Kekunle Sara audible alla. Sarada kekunle. Sara kekunle Sara. No, we are not able to hear you. സാർ ഒന്ന് കേൾക്കണില്ലേ സാറേ ഒന്ന് കേൾക്കണ്ട സാർ കാര്യം ചെയ്യോ സാറേ സാർ ഒന്ന് ലോഗൗട്ടായിട്ട് ഒന്നുകൂടി ഒന്ന് കയറി നോക്കൂ അതെ അതെ നിങ്ങൾ ഇനി സംസാരിക്കല്ലട്ടാ
ഞാൻ റെഡിയാണ് കേട്ടോ
റെഡിയാണ്
Hello, good morning, sir. Srijay, sir. Hello. Hello.
Good morning, everyone. There are some technical difficulties. We'll resolve the issue soon. Kindly wait on.
Dear participants, a very good morning. We'll be starting the program in a couple of minutes. Kindly hold on. We have a small technical issue. So we are resolving it. So please do hold on. We'll start in a couple of minutes.
Is it audible right now?
Yes, sir. Yeah. We can hear you.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Now it's fine.
Yeah. It's audible, right?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Give me a minute, actually. So just want to get my PPT.
Do you want to check it out, sir?
Yes, it's fine, actually. So within a minute, I'll start.
Okay, so I think we'll start the program.
Right.
Good morning, everyone. There is great relevance to research in education. Apart from ensuring an in-depth knowledge over a topic, research papers also contribute to the world of knowledge. These lend a helping hand to students as well as fellow research scholars. On that note, it is my pleasure to welcome every one of you to Professor K.J. Joseph Endowment Lecture Series, number 4, organized by the Department of Commerce, Christ College, Autonomous, Irinyalakuda. We will start with a silent prayer. Thank you, everyone. Now I invite Professor Muvesh Murali, Assistant Professor, Department of Commerce, Christ College, for the welcome address. Sir, please.
Morning. Reverend Father Dr. Charlie Andrews, Principal, Christ College, Irinyalakuda. Resource person of the day, Dr. Srijesh S., Assistant Professor, IIM, Kozhikode. Professor K.J. Joseph, retired professor and coordinator of BCom Self-Financing. Dr. Joshina Jose, HOD of Commerce. Professor Shine Paul, Webinar Series Coordinator. And my dear teachers from other colleges, students and research colleagues from other colleges and Christ College, and my dear colleagues, good morning, one and all. This is the fourth session in the KJJ Endowment Webinar Series. First of all, I would like to welcome Reverend Father Dr. Jolie Andrews, CMI, Principal, Christ College, Irinyalakuda. And energetic captain of Christ family. He always give support and valuable suggestions for all the departmental activities. On behalf of all gathered here, I would like to extend a warm welcome to you, dear Father.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Father. It's a moment of great privilege and honor for me to extend hearty welcome to Dr. Srijesh S. in this memorable event of K.J. Joseph Endowment Webinar Series. He started his career as assistant professor in June 2014 at IBS Business School, Hyderabad. At present, he is working as assistant professor, IIM Kozhikode. He has academic interest in various areas like research and teaching. His research interest includes various areas like online marketing, advertising, service marketing, social media marketing, etc. He is an expert in various softwares like R programming, IBM, SPSS AMOS, etc. He has 8 PhD in his credit, and he has more than 50 publications in reputed and well-rated journals. He acted as resource person more than 50 FDP and MDP. I heartily welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
The man behind this memorable event, Professor K.J. Joseph, retired professor, Christ College, Irinjalakuda, and BCom Self-Financing Coordinator. With due respect, I welcome Professor K.J. Joseph to this webinar. Then our HOD, Dr. Joshina Jose, is always with us. I extend a warm welcome you, teacher. Then Professor Shine Paul, coordinator of this webinar series, I welcome you, Miss. All the participants and all my colleagues, welcome you all. Thank you.
Right, we can start, right? Is it? Shall we start?
Thank you, sir. We have with us Reverend Dr. Jolly Andrews, CMI, our principal, who is a keen follower of our lecture series and also an avid researcher himself. It is my honor to invite Father Principal for the presidential address. Father, please.
Okay. I know it's already the time to start the webinar series.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hear me? Okay. Yes. Thank you. Dr. S. Rijesh, the resource person of the day from IIM Kozhikode. Dr. Joshina Jose, the HOD of the department. Professor Shine Paul, the coordinator, Professor Muish Murli, who made the welcome note, Dr. Arun, who will be proposing the vote of thanks, Professor K.J. Joseph, on whose name we are having this webinar, respected faculty members, and my dear friends. I'm very happy to note that we have got a lot many number of participants who are eagerly waiting to hear what Dr. Srijesh will be speaking from IIM Kozhikode. And the topic is very, very interesting. What all things we should go for as a research has been concerned, how we can influence our research, our academic career by doing a good number of research. And we have got a very, very learned professor here who will be speaking to us from IIM Kozhikode. I hope you and wish you all the best. I'm happy to say that Christ College will be receiving today a state award from perhaps from the Chief Minister of the Kerala, the G.V. Raja Award for the best sports promoting college in the state of the Kerala. So I'm on the way to receive that award with Vice Principals and HOD Dr. B.P. Aravinda. So have a wonderful time. And let us enhance ourselves as far as this research career has been concerned. Thank you. Have a nice time. Thank you so much, Professor C.J., for coming forward and helping our students and having this K.J. Joseph webinar series. I also thank Professor K.J. Joseph in a very, very special way. My hats off and congratulations to Department of Commerce for having this webinar series in a very wonderful manner. This is the fourth one. Have a wonderful time. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. We do apologize for the delay caused. It was due to some technical difficulties. Now, we'll start with the lecture by Dr. S. Srijesh S., Assistant Professor and Research Guide at the Indian Institute of Management, Calicut. I welcome, sir, for his lecture on research publication strategy for an academic career. Sir, please.
Thank you. So, good morning, everyone.
I believe the participant, if you want to switch on your video, you can switch on the video. So otherwise, you know, it will be, you know, one-to-one interaction. So if you can, if you want to switch on the video, you can switch on the video, please. All right. So if you look at, frankly speaking, I have almost 1 hour time to talk about research and publication strategy, especially for academic area. And that is a very short duration, and it's very difficult for me to, you know, complete everything within half an hour or max 1 hour. It's quite tough, actually. Please understand that if you have any concern or have any questions, you can write back to me at the end of this particular session. And I'm just trying to summarize what I experienced looking at my career the last 10 years, 12 years down the line. I got a little bit of experience as a researcher, so I'm just trying to share my experience. At that time, it's very tough to summarize my experience within 1 hour. So please make sure that you are able to link or connect what I'm just trying to deliver, right? If you have any concern in between, you can rise and so that I can address it. So now, the first thing would be, I believe everyone is in the stage of, you know, a research, just started research or just halfway of research, and you all want to, you know, publish in very good journal papers. So that's what you are trying to attend this particular program, is it? So I believe you're all beginners. That's the reason, you know, you are trying to attend it, is it? Or otherwise you are trying to improve your journal publication or the level of publication, that's the reason, is it? So now, when I'm looking at this presentation, I'm just trying to look at, as a beginner, where to focus on and where to start on so that you can get some kind of understanding with respect to this particular beautiful domain of publication, right? So where to start, the fundamental question that everyone asks. And if you ask me a question that where to start, I would say that you always need to identify the domain, which domain you would like to work with. And probably it can be a commerce, economics, management, anything, right? It can be, right? So from that domain, you need to identify a subdomain. It's like, you know, for me, it's marketing. And probably you may identify some other areas as well, right? So first thing would be, you need to identify your area of interest. Always start working on that area. And if it is finance or economics or management, in the sense, you know, general management or marketing, so just identify that as a researcher. Second is that, you know, you need to look at your specific area. For example, if I am working in marketing is a broad domain, is it? So very broad domain, and it's very difficult to work all the aspects from marketing. And again, don't go with, you know, some people know what they look at. They will look at the very attractive areas in marketing. For example, if you interact with a research scholar, if they are in the first year of their PhD, they will say that, you know, always work with something quite interesting. For example, artificial intelligence and marketing, and big data and marketing. So some people identify like that. So instead of identifying or specifying the domain at the beginning, what do you do? Don't you identify your specific area, that is online marketing or social media marketing or advertising or in finance, capital budgeting or something like that. The first and most important thing, I just recommend that, you know, you need to go back to the research databases, So that's the first thing you need to do. So what is the database? Again, you may ask a question, because remember, whenever you do research, we always need to read the related papers or related research papers in this domain. It is very, very important. It's not like, you know, please don't try to get your area or your idea from your dream. So as part of that, I just recommend that the first thing would be probably what you can do. You can identify your broad area. From there onwards, you can come down to specific area. And from the specific areas, probably you can do, or you can identify specific set of keywords, which probably you are trying to, specific set of keywords in your domain. And for example, if I'm looking at advertising, online advertising, so I can look at some keywords such as digital advertising, online advertising, internet advertising, search advertising. So these kind of keywords probably deliver some kind of, you know, research understanding this domain. And please identify the very exhaustive list of keywords. Why these keywords are necessary? Because in your domain, you understood the point? Research papers in the domain. So make sure that you have a very list of exhaustive list of keyword, and then go to databases. Databases specifically, you may ask a question, what are those databases? As a researcher, you can probably go. I believe everyone, majority of them are working in management, commerce, economics, or social science domain. And I'm familiar with that domain. That's the reason I'm just telling. And the beautiful database would be ScienceDirect. There is a database. I believe everyone is aware of what is ScienceDirect. Are you aware of ScienceDirect at all? You can write to me through your chat so that I can understand your understanding. So can you write to me actually? Are you aware of ScienceDirect as a platform? ScienceDirect? I'll show you what is that platform all about. That's a beautiful platform in terms of looking at your research papers. So this is a platform, the first and most important platform. Have you seen this platform ever? This is ScienceDirect, but I'm just getting through my own library. That's the reason you can see here. And otherwise, you can type in Google www.sciencedirect.com. So this is a beautiful platform to get research papers. And here in this, you can type your keyword, for example, online marketing. You type the keywords here, you can do a search, right? You can do an online search. And if you do an online search, you can identify the papers here. And remember, when you're looking at the papers, identify the papers related to this is actually in the nursing discipline. So I just don't want to read that paper, right? So it's, again, it's not into my domain. So, and you may ask a question that how do you identify it's not into your domain? Because looking at the journal, I can easily identify that, you know, whether it's into my domain or International Journal of Nursing Sciences. So nursing sciences, I'm not working in nursing sciences, therefore it's not my domain, right? And generally we believe that a journal definitely target papers or reflect. For example, you look at this paper. All right, look at this. It's into broad area of management actually. So because I'm working in management, I feel that it's in hospitality management. It may probably have some kind of, again, 7 pieces of marketing and online reviews. And again, you can come down. There are some papers here in Journal of Retailing and Consumer Services, right? So likewise, you can download the papers and you can store in your hard disk or in your database, wherever you want to save, you can save it actually. So first thing would be my suggestion is that, I mean, where we started from a very broad domain. From the broad domain, we identified a specific domain. From the specific domain, you have identified a set of keywords, right? Set of keywords, right? Here, I have applied one single keyword, right? Online marketing based on this particular keyword. I'm just trying to get papers. And I'll make sure that I'll download almost all the papers, right? So that's what. And so that is one such very beautiful platform you can use to download papers, right? ScienceDirect. Are you people are active or there is no response from that side? Yes, right. So in addition to that, all of you are in the area of marketing, management or some other discipline, mathematics or physics or chemistry. Is it there? Any other commerce? Okay, right. But still, it's okay, fine, actually. Even if you are working in fundamental science, generally, this would be the search process we do in terms of identifying research papers, right? Remember, again, I just try to give you an insight that ScienceDirect is a paid platform, very paid platform. It's a subscription-based platform, right? You won't be able to download papers without any kind of subscription. So we need subscription, right? Is it so? Again, let's assume that you don't have subscription and please leave it and you can look at some institute like universities and all. For example, if you look at any university in Kerala, they may have access to ScienceDirect. You can go to their library, you can download it. That's what the process you can do. And again, Ninu asked a question that, what about Google Scholar? I'll tell you the suggestion. The thing is that Google Scholar, you will be able to find almost all the works related to this keyword. If you do a keyword search in Google Scholar, you will be able to identify n number of papers irrespective of the domain. So you need to be a bit careful. Google Scholar is not actually a platform to download papers. Rather, you will get insights about the published papers. That is one platform. And again, in addition to that, you have other platforms such as EBSCO. Have you heard of EBSCO? So look at your chat. You can see the chat there, I just mentioned EBSCOhost actually. So EBSCOhost, if you want to see the platform, I can show you. Do you want to see the platform? Let me look at your chat window. Yes, give me a second. I'll show you the platform as such so that you can. Just give me a second. Yeah, can you see my screen right now?
Yes, sir.
Right, this is a platform here. The same thing you can do. This is another platform. Remember again, if you look at this platform, if you look at this platform versus a previous platform, oh, there is a noise actually, background noise. So can you mute? Someone is actually unmuted. Can you mute? You're right. This is another platform here. Right, I'll do.
Sir, I have muted it.
You're right. Still.
Okay, yeah.
Fine. So this is another platform from where you can get papers, right? So this is also B2B. But remember, if you look at this platform, this is a platform supported by Elsevier. And remember, Elsevier is a well-known publisher. Elsevier published journals. Remember, I believe you understood what do you mean by Elsevier. Elsevier is a publisher, the very well-known publisher in the domain of, you can say that social science or in fundamental science. Elsevier is a well-known publisher. And here you can see in this platform, you can see only Elsevier supported journals, right? But at the same time, if you look at EBSCO, so irrespective of the publisher, you can see this papers here, but the problem here is that it is not a very superior search platform. It's not a very superior platform. So not a great platform, but it's still okay, fine. If you want to get a very exhaustive list of papers, it's fine, right? Again, you have something called as Proquest. This is another platform. It's called as Proquest. And the beauty of this platform is that in this platform, you can also download thesis, PhD thesis, right? That's the beauty of somebody want to see PhD thesis for their PhD works. And this is a very good platform in terms of getting, again, there is a warning, at some institutions, you may have limited access, right? Sometimes you may go to some institutions, there, when you search PhD thesis, you won't be able to find PhD thesis there because they have subscription of very limited access, right? You need to make sure that you have full access, then only you can download it, right? So this, again, we have a lot many other platforms like Emerald. Have you heard of Emerald? This is another platform where they also covers very wide range of journals, very wide range of journals, very wide range of journals. And this is a
excuse platform. Me, sir, your voice is break.
Okay. What about right now?
Now, okay.
It's fine. Okay. You can guide yourself. It's fine.
All right. So this is another platform where you can find, I mean, remember this platform is specifically for social science. And probably you'll find very less number of journals in the field of fundamental science, and especially in Emerald. But at the same time, if you look at Science Direct, it covers very wide range of journal, which is in the area of fundamental science and other sciences, right? So that is another. And again, in addition to that, we have very well-known publishing houses like Taylor & Francis. right? Terre and France is actually having very exhaustive list of journals, and some institutions, they have separate access to Terre and France's publishing platform. And probably you can also identify Terre and France's. So let me check. Less in between, I'll show you this one. Wiley is another, actually. So Wiley's publishing house is also another. And Wiley is also another well-known publishing house. And whichever journals, it's part of Wiley. And you can also download from this particular platform. Again, remember, you need to make sure that your institution got subscription to this platform, then only you can download it. And again, you may ask another question that if we don't have access to that platform, how do we get it? So the answer is that probably if you don't have access to this platform, better, you look at some institutions where they have access, you can go there, you can get permission from there. In IMK, for example, if you come down, we don't actually... be able to get only through the campus access, that's it. You need to be there in the campus, then only you can access all these platforms. So these are the very popular platform through which you can download papers related to your domain, related to your area, right? And again, my suggestion is that when you're looking at papers, make sure that you have done very exhaustive search in almost all these domains, all these databases, all these databases. And again, that's what I'm saying. Don't do a random search. Some people do always a random search. For example, they will go to Google, they will Google it, and they will identify some papers. Whenever they see the first 4 or 5 papers or 10 papers, they will read that paper. That's it, actually. So that's nothing but a random search, actually. So the problem is that if you do a random search, you may, deliberately ignoring some very relevant research papers, because most of these subscription-based platforms, and it's very difficult to find in Google as such, Google Scholar as such, because sometimes it'll be there in the last pages of Google search. And when you do a search, first page, there will be a list of papers, second page, another list of papers. So if you do a search, first 4 or 5 pages you will look at, and subsequent pages you will not visit. Therefore, there is a high chance that you may miss some very relevant papers. Miss some very relevant papers, and make sure that when you are actually looking at a search, you are including very relevant papers at the same time excluding irrelevant papers. And that is very important criteria. And many people ask me a question that, let's assume that I'm doing search in almost all these databases. Let's assume I'm getting 300 papers or 400 papers in your domain assets. Is it so? So first time you can't read all these papers, looking at the title and abstract, you can download it. That's what I told you. Is it so? For example, you are finding a paper in your Google Scholar or in your search engines like Science Direct, Emerald, or Wiley. You cannot read all the papers at the front, is it? Rather, looking at the title and abstract, you're downloading the papers, right? That's what I did. Is it so? Right. So let's assume you have 300 or 350 papers in your folder, 350 papers, right? I mean, where I just started, I said that when you start to do a research, the first and most important thing would be you need to understand the domain. That's the reason where I started the search for papers. Is it so? Now, when I started this particular process, I just downloaded 350 papers. Let's make a presumption, 350 papers, right? So 350 papers. Now, can you read all these 350 papers? At the front end, you found that everything is very relevant, right? Everything is relevant because that's the reason you download it, right? At the same time, you made a search in very good databases. Is it so? Science Direct, a very top tier database. Procurs, you did. EBSCO, you did. And Emerald, you did. And also, you actually deleted some overlapping papers, right? For example, some of the databases, they have overlapping, right? For example, Procurs and EBSCO. The same papers you can see there in both the platform. Is it so? Because they have subscription to both the set of journals. Is it so? So what you do, you'll delete some overlapping papers. Is it so? And finally, you would be able to get around 350 papers, right? Will you read all the 350? If not, then tell me your strategy. So how do you identify which are those papers which is very relevant? Because 350 is a very exhaustive list. Is it so?
very huge number, right? So at the same time, you don't require, if it's a thesis and all, you may require actually very exhaustive list, but 350 is too much. Is it? Now, how do you eliminate? Because we need an elimination criteria, right? Will you eliminate based on your perception, based on your understanding? Based on your understanding, what strategy will you do? I mean, I'm just asking, what's an exclusion? What is your exclusion and inclusion criteria? I'm just asking exclusion and inclusion criteria. Because sample we got, is it so? 350 is a sample, is it? And how do you confirm that? How do you confirm that all these papers, your sample is actually a very good sample? How do you confirm that? Because you did a search in very good databases, such as EBSCO, Procast, ScienceDirect, Emerald, Wiley and all, right? Is it so? Right? In addition to that, you also went through some journals, which is not part of any of these databases. Is it so? There are some very good journals, which is not part of these databases. Is it? Sometimes there will be. For example, there are some independent organizations in any domain, and they have independent journals, but it is well-reputed journals, but which is not part of any of these databases. For example, there is a journal called as Journal of Advertising Research in our domain, which is not part of any of these databases, but at the same time, very well-reputed journal. Right? If I am doing a research in the domain of advertising, if I'm not reading Journal of Advertising Research, it will be a crime. But if I search that journal in ScienceDirect, I'll not find. In EBSCO, I'll not find. In Procast, I'll not find. Nowhere I'll find. Is it so? But at the same time, I need to make sure that I also did a very exhaustive search, not only in databases, but also in journal web pages. Right. Now you may ask a question, that how do you identify that these journals are very relevant? First point is that, listen very carefully, that you know, when you are in your domain, definitely you should know what are the very best journals to read. Right, first thing. And you need to develop that sensitivity after some point in time. And if you are very much unfamiliar, probably you can ask someone that, you know, I'm working in this domain, what are those important journals I need to read? Or journal papers from those journals I need to read. It's a must journals, right? There are some must journals, right? Is it so? Now, come back to my question again. We have very limited time. That's the reason I'm just telling. So how do you eliminate, right? How do you actually, you know, subset actually, or how do you select very relevant papers so that you can continue that? Tell me the strategy. I can give you a suggestion. Probably what you can do, you can follow some criteria in the sense, please don't make any biased criteria in the sense, don't make selection based on your own intuition. Then don't do random selection because it'll create some kind of bias. For example, if you randomly select something, and if you write a literature review, and there can be a chance that people ask a question, what is the criteria under which you selected all these papers? Are you sure that these are the papers which is very much essential for your literature review? Right? So I will use the word this way. I'll say that since in my area, there are 350 papers, I just use an open search based on these keywords. And finally, I found 350 journal papers, which is relevant up the front. Right? And what after that? After that, I just did a screening based on Scopus listing. Scopus, have you heard of Scopus? No? No. Okay. So Scopus, you have some doubts. What is Scopus? Can you see my screen right now? Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir. We can see.
Yes.
Right. So it simply, in my case, can you type up to here, scopus.com? In Google, if you type www.scopus.com, you will get into this web page, but make sure that you need to create a personal login ID. I mean, remember, this is very free. Very free. You don't need to have subscription for this. It is very free. Right. And now, go to www.scopus.com. There'll be a login, and you need to log in using your own personal ID. You can create a login based on your Gmail account or something, or institutional account. And there you can get into this platform. And in this platform, you can see something here called as content coverage on the left side. Can you see something here, content coverage? Right. Yes. So if I click on content coverage, I'll be directed to another window. And can you see my screen? Just tell me yes or no.
So yes, yes, yes.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Now, here if you go down, you can see something here. Download source title list. Right? Download book title list. Discontinued sources from Scopus. So I'll tell you what is this actually. This is our most recent list of Scopus listed journals. Right? It is an Excel file. Which is an Excel file. You can click on here so that you can download it. It'll take some time because it covers very exhaustive list of journals. Very exhaustive list of journals, therefore it'll take some time. And this provides you the complete list of journals, which is in the domain, almost all the domains, not only your domain. It covers very wide range of domains, right? That's the first thing. Which actually look at, if you look at download book title list, there you will get very exhaustive list of book, which is part of Scopus. Here, if you look at discontinued from Scopus, right? So that is a very difficult story to tell you, but still I'll give you a summary. The first thing is, let's assume that I have a journal and doing very good actually, and I got indexed as part of Scopus. I mean, you understood what is Scopus, right? It's an indexing agency. What is indexing? It's like, you know, ISO certification, right? In journals, very authentic certification or indexing, we call it as indexing, we call it as Scopus. Very authentic, very authentic. Authentic in the sense, you know, how do you say that it's authentic? Because everyone accepts at least. That's what I call it, authentic, right? Social consensus, right? Is it? I call it a social consensus. Respective of domain, if you go anywhere in the world, if you say that I have a Scopus list, probably people identify. Now, so let's assume I have a journal, name is X, right? And I've been doing good, right? I'm part of Scopus last year. Let's assume I'm part of Scopus last year because Scopus found that my journal is really interesting. Scopus said that we will index you in our list. So right now, I'm just part of Scopus. Just assume that I'm just part of Scopus, right? Now, what will happen after some point in time, I just relax my journal quality criteria. Journal quality criteria. What will happen in subsequent year, Scopus analyze the quality criteria, which is followed by journal. If Scopus feels that this journal is not following any kind of quality criteria recommended by Scopus, Scopus will eliminate that journal from the list in subsequent years. Have you understood the point? So it is called as discontinued from the Scopus list. So it means that subsequent years, it may eliminate some of the journal from the list. Eliminate. So it means that if you are part of Scopus for first time, it's not sure that you're not sure that it will be there forever. You may get actually, you know, eliminated after some point in time based on the quality requirement followed by or recommended by Scopus, right? You need the list? You need the list right now? Give me a second. I'm just trying to share it. You people need the list? I'm not able to share actually. Yeah. Give me a second. You're able to download the Scopus list, is it so? Okay, fine. Now, so that is one list actually. So what I'll do, so I was coming back to my mode. So here, what I do, I look at the Scopus. And if it is part of Scopus, what I'll do, I will include my review. Otherwise, I eliminate my review, right? So what I do, I will look at all my 350 journal papers. I will look at whether it's part of Scopus or not. If it is not part of Scopus, I will eliminate. So that's what the process. Let's assume that you did actually a screening where you found that out of 350 and 210 papers are part of Scopus index journals. Scopus index journals, right? Is it so? Let's assume a situation. Now, my question is that, is it okay that, you know, you can go with 210 paper? Is it sufficient? Or is it less or more? So what is 210? It is again more, Ninu said, again more. Now it means that Ninu want to again eliminate some of the papers because she don't want to include again some more journal papers. Is it so? Is it? right? Now, some people ask a question that in that case, what I do actually, what is another criteria I can use so that I can further, is it? Now, we have again, if you don't want to actually again continue with this corpus list, because corpus gives you around 210 papers, what you can do, instead of looking at corpus, we can look at a very strict indexing service, is it so? Very strict indexing service. Corpus contains very elaborate list of journals. Therefore, there is a high likelihood that whatever papers you actually got right now will be part of actually Scopus, right? Is it so? There will be a high chance, is it so? There will be more number of papers you can accommodate if you use Scopus, right? At the same time, you want to eliminate further. How do you eliminate? We need very strict criteria so that we can eliminate further. Is it so? What is that criteria you can follow? If you want to eliminate something again, what is that criteria? Any understanding about the criteria? Have you heard of Web of Science? Yes or no? Yeah. So probably what you can do, you can come down to Web of Science, and you can confirm that the journal which is actually your papers you are referring right now is part of Web of Science. And it means that Web of Science is a very, very strict list of journals, very high quality journals compared to Scopus. Let's assume that Scopus contains 5,000 journals. Web of Science contains probably around 2,000 journals. So that much difference is there. It means that very high quality journal papers are there part of Web of Science, right? So you can, Web of Science is also a subscription-based platform. And you can do a search here. And again, you can identify whether it's part of Web of Science or not. And again, one more thing. And generally, Web of Science publishes a report called as Journal Citation Report. So what is Journal Citation Report? Which is nothing but the citation received by Web of Science listed journals during last year. You understood the point? Generally, institution can subscribe this journal citation report. It's provided here, right? Institutions can subscribe this journal citation report. And this is relatively expensive affair. I can cite, it's called as JCR, right? What is JCR? So JCR is nothing but a service provided by Web of Science, which provides you the citations received by Web of Science listed journals during last year, and also provides you an impact factor. And that is called as JIF, or Journal Impact Factor, JIF. Journal Impact Factor, and that Journal Impact Factor called is as Clarivate Analytics Impact Factor. What is that? Clarivate Analytics Impact Factor, right? So now that is actually very well accepted impact factor. And generally, if you look at some of the journals will say that our journal got an impact factor, right? But the concept of impact factor is from Clarivate Analytics. And most of the impact factors provided by some other agencies are predatory impact factors. We won't trust actually, or we won't recommend that impact factor because it is bogus. It is not very trustworthy. At the same time, the impact factor provided by this journal, for example, here, Journal of Interactive, let's assume I'm typing a journal here. Here it'll give you a suggestion. You can see my screen, right? Is it?
Yes, sir, we can see it.
Here, can you see the impact factor of the journal?
Yes, sir.
Right? And also see the citation over the years. The latest impact factor is 2019 impact factor, 20 impact factor yet to be published. We are waiting for that, right? And also gives you their calculations called as JIF, journal impact factor. It also provides you what are those citations received by the journal during last year. Citations 2019, right? Is it so? So every evidence is there, right? Where we got actually citations. So everything is accessible. And this is more trustworthy metrics. More trustworthy metrics. Again, you may ask another question that when I'll follow this kind of, you know, indexing services, I'll say that if your target is very high quality journals, definitely you need to look at Web of Science and JCR. And at the same time, if your objective is to look at okay journals, probably you need to look at Scopus. And beyond or below Scopus, I'll say better not to publish. Don't feel bad, actually. So it is better not to publish because you are wasting your time. Right? And it is this way, actually. So most people look at ISSN and number of journals, but mostly these journals will die after some point in time. That's a problem. Will not be there. It's pure business. Is it so? Why should we waste our energy, resources, intellectual capability, and then publishing some journal which is not there anywhere actually after some point in time? Is it so? Right? So minimum Scopus, and then you can look at your ladder, or you can improve your hierarchy, come down to Web of Science listed journals, you can focus on. Again, two things I told you. First thing is that from where you'll find or identify journal papers for your review. Second thing is what kind of journals you can publish. Is it so? Right. And now you may ask another question that, you know, we are not able to access JCR because it's very relatively expensive platform, right? How do I get impact factor and whether it's part of Scopus or Web of Science or not? Is it so? You may ask that. Scopus is free. That's what I told you. Is it so? You can download and search it. It's an Excel sheet, right? Is it so? Now, in that case, let's assume that you are not able to get JCR. If you're not able to get JCR, what you can do? You go to journal web page. For example, Journal of Interactive Marketing. And this is a journal, right? This is journal, right? Can you see something here? This is the same impact factor we found there? Is it? So it means that, right, Clarivate Analytics General Citation Report 2019 impact factor is 5.097, the same impact factor we found there. Is it so? So it means that this is part of Web of Science. Is it so? Right? So it means, again, can you see something here? Shimago Journal Rank here. This is a journal ranking related to Scopus. This is a journal ranking related to Scopus. Now you may ask that, you know, Shimago journal ranking, SJR, this much, right? I told you Scopus, from where we get actually this one, in addition to this one. If you want to get Shimago, again, what you can do in Google, you type Shimago journal rank. And here you can type, you'll be here, right? So, right, you are here, right? It's United States Elsevier publisher, right? Is it so? Now, here, can you see if the journal is not part of Shimago, you cannot see this journal here in this page. Remember, again, one more thing. If any journal is part of Shimago, that means that it is part of Scopus. Have you got the point? If any journal is part of Shimago, that means that is part of Scopus. Again, you may ask another question that let's assume that I have a paper, right? How do I identify what is the rigor of the paper? What's the ranking of the paper? Ranking, you understood what is ranking, right? It's a very top quality and okay paper. Is it so? And okay paper in the sense, you know, can you see something here down? Can you say Q1, Q2 here? Can you see Q2? 1999, right? So what are the areas of the journal? Business and international management and marketing. These are the domains of the journal. Is it so? And look at 2019 rating, Shimago rating, a ranking, we can call it as Q1. What is the ranking? Q1. What do you mean by Q1? The top 25% journals are part of Q1. It means that if a journal is Q1, that's high quality journal, very highly reputed journal. And now, you were asking something that, you know, if I want to strictly follow Scopus in terms of elimination, what I'll do, I will simply read those journals part of Q1 and Q2. Right? Q3 and Q4, I will not read. So I'll write in my review that during the review, in OpenSearch, I am able to identify 350 papers. From there onwards, as part of screening criteria or elimination criteria, we have actually searched Scopus listing using Shimago. So we retain only those journals which is part of Shimago, which is Q1 and Q2, and deleted or eliminated those journals which is Q3 and Q4. You understood the point? It means that you are retaining or reading or reviewing only Q1 and Q2 papers, and Q3 and Q4 are getting eliminated. And Q3 and Q4 are least or not high quality journals, right? It's having quality which is not of superior quality, is it? So that's what it means, is it? The least, but again, remember, these are all Scopus listed journals. These are all Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. All these are actually part of Scopus. And now again, you may ask another question. Let's assume that I have paper. My paper is not having high quality, but it's okay paper. Right? I want to publish in Scopus listed journal. Where do you focus? Will you focus Q1 straight, Q2 straight, Q3 or Q4? Which is your strategy? Your paper is okay, average or below average paper, but you want to publish in Scopus. Where do you focus actually? So when, which kind of journals you will focus? Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, what is your option? Your option would be Q3 or Q4, is it so? Because, and your journal's requirement versus your quality of your paper probably match with Q3 and Q4, is it so? Therefore, there is a high likelihood that your paper get an acceptance. At the same time, if the paper is very bad quality paper, if you target high quality journals, there is a high likelihood that they will reject your paper. They need to prioritize. Therefore, what I generally do, looking at the quality of the paper, you need to identify a journal, right? That identification probably you can look at by looking at Shimago journal ranking, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. If my paper is extremely good, I will target Q1. It's slightly lower, Q2, otherwise Q3 or Q4. And again, one more thing, there is a high likelihood that Q4 journals will get eliminated from the list in future. There is a risk. You understood the point, because they are not high quality, extremely, it's not highly quality oriented journal. They are okay. They are in the border. Right? Please understand that. And if they make any kind of compromise in future, Scopus may eliminate these journals from the list. And you need to see the uncertainty. Again, one thing, before submission, look at the journal, go to their webpage, and see how many journal papers they published. For example, let's assume you are trying to decide or you're trying to publish a paper in a Q4 journal. That journal last year published 5,000 papers. Let's assume 5,000 papers. They are charging around 5,000 rupees. So it means that there is a chance that they may get eliminated because they are compromising quality, because they are accepting almost every paper. Is it so? Yes or no? I believe you understood what I'm trying to say. So it means that you can understand their philosophy or their quality criteria by looking at last year publication, the kind of papers they publish, the kind of orientation they have actually in their papers. Looking at that, you can easily decide whether the journal got a great future or not. Now, I believe so far it's clear to you, right? Is it so? So I discussed that, how do you search and how do you identify? Now, so after getting all these papers, let's assume that you are able to stick to around 120 papers. My suggestion is that read all these papers one by one. And get your idea or confirm your idea after reading all these papers. And now, why it's important? Because tomorrow, if you're trying to target a good journal for your paper, you need to make sure that your idea is not there anywhere as such. First thing. Is it so? Second thing is that even if you come up with the idea, you can easily justify why there is a need to study this idea. You can easily, because you read 120 papers. After reading 120 papers, you can see the difference. Your thought process will change. And third is that after reading 120 papers, you will understand how to conduct research. After reading 120 papers, you will understand actually how to do analysis. And after reading 120 papers, you will understand how to write a paper. Right? Where to focus on, right? So everything you'll understand. So ultimately, now you decide actually where you are lagging. Is it problem with your research orientation? No. Your problem with reading, is it so? You are not reading properly. That's the reason, is it so? Right? It means that you haven't done a proper literature review. That's the reason, right? It means that why there is a need to conduct literature review or do literature review, because literature review teach you a lot of things about research. If you're a great reader, especially in the area of research, I mean research, many people read textbooks. That is especially research methodology textbook to learn research. And can I ask you something? In which research methodology textbook you mention all this detailed process? They will talk about some kind of methodology, some kind of analysis, but nowhere you will not be able to connect, right? Is it so? But if you read a very good paper, very good research paper, you can easily connect. What is their idea? What kind of hypothesis they formulated? What kind of methodology they proposed? What kind of analysis they done? In addition to that, how they beautifully written the paper and so that they got into the journal. Is it so? Now, at least after reading one single paper, you will get an understanding that where to focus on, how to focus on. Right. Again, my suggestion is don't make sure that you're reading everything within a week. It will not happen. It's not going to happen because it's going to be very, very tough because it's written by very great academicians in your domain. Very great academicians, right? And again, very great academics, you can understand. Again, remember, when you write a paper tomorrow, they are going to read your paper. Is it so? Therefore, you need to understand that you are delivering something for others. And tomorrow, if they read your paper, if they find that there are some loopholes, I don't think they will accept your paper. It means that when you are writing a paper, after reading their paper, you need to think beyond their level. Is it so? So it means that you need to prepare yourself that, yes, you can defend anyone in that domain. Is it so? So ultimately, are you writing a paper for yourself? No. You're writing papers for others, right? Is it so? It means that somebody like you is getting influence afterwards. Is it? Right. It is the field where you are influencing others. Is it so? And they are understanding, they are enhancing the knowledge. Finally, you are part of the knowledge building process. Is it so? Is it? Right. That is all about the story. I believe all of you are able to connect. How do we start? Where do we start? How do we link? Where do we actually learn? How do we learn? How do we actually conduct research? Right. Is it so? And my suggestion is that instead of reading research methodology textbook from the day one, you start reading research articles. Read the best. When you're reading, read the best, actually. Otherwise, don't read. Right? And read the best. Again, make your planning for next 6 months. I'll read one paper one by one and make it in chronological order. For example, the first paper, right? And otherwise, you lose the link. For example, if you start reading a 2020 paper first and 2019-80 paper later, you will not find the connection. Make the priority there. Make the priority there and make note of it, actually. Probably you can prepare an Excel sheet. And even before preparing an Excel sheet, what you can do, the complete set of 120 papers, you can group. You can group. For example, based on concept delivered in the paper, you can make folders. Folder 1, folder 2, folder 3, folder 4, up to 10 folder you can make. Keep all these papers into different folders based on the concept delivered in this paper. That you can understand just after reading the abstract. Just after reading the abstract, you can easily understand. Don't make sure that you know you are reading everything at a stretch and reading in generic way. Read segment by segment, group by group, so that you can link. You understood the point? Keep it in different folder and prepare separate sheet for each folder. Excel sheet, you just make the points actually. and keep the Excel sheet with you so that in future, if you are getting any concern, you can read the points noted in the Excel sheet so that you can easily recollect. And at the beginning, in a month, one paper or something like that. After some point in time, in a week, one paper. That's the practice you can do. So that if you do the process, definitely at the end of 1 year, probably you can see a great change in your understanding. Great change in your understanding, right? So I believe all of you understood what I'm trying to explain, right? So now, that is all about this process. Now, just read it and try to get your research gap out of these papers. And again, make sure that after reading 120 papers, I'm pretty sure that you'll get an idea first. Again, if you get an idea, you will understand whether the idea is unique or not. Is it so? So you can easily understand the uniqueness of the idea after reading the papers. That's what I'm trying to say, right? Now, then you identify the idea. And my suggestion is that please write the idea in a paper. Don't wait to get the perfect idea at the day one. You will not find. And for example, if I'm a researcher, I just want to get a perfect idea today itself, it will not happen. When I get an idea, let's assume generally after doing PhD, you are doing research papers, right? So when I get an idea, what I do, I just don't want to do myself because I have time issues. Again, the problem is that if sometimes you may think that the idea is so great. So I will contact to some of my co-authors. I'll ask them, actually, this is what my idea. I thought of doing a paper in this area. And are you interested in doing a paper? If they say yes, I'll communicate my idea. Then we'll debate over the idea. So when we debate over the idea, probably they will interact and they will say that, yes, there are problems with this respective idea. This can be modified in this way. And finally, we'll debate, discuss, and we'll modify the idea. I mean, immediately, I'll just say that I'll write down the idea. Now, as per our discussion, I'll send it back to you. If you have any comments, please revert back to me immediately. Immediately. Don't take too much time. If your co-author is taking, you know, 1 month time, actually, you'll forget things. And make sure that you are getting a co-author. He's very prompt in terms of doing things. And when they are replying back to you, and immediately come and write back to them saying that this is what the problems with respect to this. And again, modify. Do the process again and again. Completely confirm your idea after a series of interactions. After a series of interaction. So I believe you understood the point. Is it so? And do or discuss idea with others who can understand what you want to communicate. That is the best way in which you can do. Right? And again, many times, your co-authors should also be familiar with the area. They also read the papers in the area. Some of the co-authors, what they do, they won't read the papers in the area. They will think based on their own intuition. So intuition will not work. Because in the field, there are people who written the papers in a better way. And now if you read the paper, you will understand ideology differently. You can ask the co-author, can you read this paper? Then we'll get some kind of understanding. Right? Probably you can read this paper and then we'll discuss it. Right? And don't think that, you know, this is no way related to my teaching, therefore I don't need to read it. And many of us actually what they do, we read only abstract. We read title and abstract. So that is what our paper reading, right? So that's what literature review means. A literature review means title, abstract. That's sufficient actually. After the next paper, if you ask them actually, can you do a literature review? What they do, they will summarize abstract once again. They will be back immediately with literature. Don't do that actually. It's a crime. Crime in the sense, you know, you are actually destroying yourself. That's it. Don't do that, actually. It's a crime, right? Now, so after getting the idea, immediately you write down the idea, modify the idea, and revise the idea. And again, don't create your own style. Beginners always get the style from published papers. Try to imitate them. Imitate in the sense, you know, don't copy-paste. Rather, you can understand their style. For example, out of 120 papers, one paper attracted your attention, right? Beautifully written. And how they presented it. So you think actually whether I can present my idea in this way or not. Right? Accordingly, you do that and just start writing the idea accordingly. And make sure that every sentence you write, it got some meaning. There is a connectivity there. And some people say that, you know, I wrote this sentence, it's not meaningful, but I can't delete because I took a lot of time for that. Remember, and if you, sometimes you take actually 1 day to write one paragraph, but still, you know, sometime after 3 days, if you read the paper or read the paragraph, you'll find it's irrelevant. There is no meaning because you are able to think right now because there is a break in your mind. Is it so? every time we are very much biased, because when you write, actually, we are trying to justify, because your father asks some question, you'll defend. No, you are wrong. So instead of looking at that as a fight mode, you try to understand what he's trying to communicate, right? And try to appreciate each other in the sense, you know, whether you're going hand in hand so that the paper is getting developed or not. That's what the sole purpose, right? Doesn't matter what he's telling a superior, or you are actually a senior professor, or he's a junior professor, so I can't accept their viewpoints and all. Doesn't matter, actually. In research, there is no senior, junior, but depends on sensitivity, what extent you are familiar with the area, right? And now, so write the idea, purify the idea, rewrite it again and again and again and again. So do the modification, right? And do the modification, and accordingly you complete the paper. When you complete the paper, and even before completing the paper itself, you can identify your target journal. Don't wait for completing the paper to identify a journal. Let's assume that you read 120 papers, right? Is it so? And you are citing these papers in your paper, right? Is it so? In your paper, is it so? When you're citing, look at which journal is cited repeatedly. I mean, for example, let's assume in my paper, Journal of Business Research is cited almost, 20 times. 20 journal papers are cited. Definitely, that is going to be my avenue, because my paper are carrying higher 11th JBR or Journal of Business Research. Is it so? And now again, the question is that whether your paper carrying that much quality to target JBR or not. If it not having that much quality, again, you think of another journal which probably match with your paper versus their requirement. And mostly it is actually identified based on what journal or what journal paper is getting cited repeatedly. It means there is higher relevance. Your paper is carrying higher relevance with respect to that journal. You understood the point? Identify journal. And once you identify journal, go back to the journal web page, right? And understand what is their requirement during their submission. Follow very meticulously. For example, journal says that 8,000 words paper, write a paper, maximum 8,500 words, that's it. Or 9,000 words, don't cross that limit. Some people, what they do, they'll write a paper for 15,000 at the beginning. Afterwards, they will target a journal. They found that 8,000 words. What they do, they will delete some paragraph. When they delete paragraph, you lose the link actually. So please don't do that. Day one, you target the journal accordingly, you go ahead, right? Is it so? Is it clear? Right, now. So once you do that, submit your paper through your journal portal. I mean, every journal got actually an online submission system. An online submission system, we call it this Manuscript Central. Manuscript Central, right? And you submit it, follow all the requirements. All the requirements of the journal. If you go to the journal webpage, there is a separate section called as guide for authors. Every journal, there is a separate section called as guide for authors. And in that guide, main, they will mention what is the requirement during submission, what kind of papers they demand, what is the writing style, what is the reference style. It's not audible. It's not audible. You want to ask some questions? You're asking some questions? Your name is not visible, but Redmi is the title. You have any questions? Stu? No. Okay.
So there's a question from Ninu C. Asking, if we need to firstly select the journal and write a paper, or firstly write the paper and then select the journal?
No, my suggestion is that I'll write a paper for the journal. So I may have always a very target journal in my mind. How do I get target journal? One can be, I've been reading papers in the area. I know which journal I need to target next. First thing. Or I'm a beginner. When I'm reading papers, I may get influenced by some of the journal papers. And again, I'll identify that this is what my avenue, so that I'll write accordingly. So I have a journal in my mind. Every sentence I write in my paper, I'll write accordingly. Every sentence. You understood the point? Every sentence. So that's what I do. And I will not wait to complete the paper. Rather, I just look at journal. Based on the journal requirement, I'll write the paper. That's what I do. I have a dream journal in my mind every time when I actually start my writing. So I'll complete my paper. I'll submit my paper. And every journal nowadays follows an online submission system. And when we follow online submission system, the first thing, it will go to editorial desk. So in top journals, there is an editorial desk. And editorial desk is not actually purely contains academicians. What they do, they will check your technical aspects of the paper. Technical aspects in the sense whether the journal follows page restrictions, word restrictions, referencing style, formatting style, and all. And if your paper is not following any of these, editorial desk reject your paper. Editorial desk in the sense, you know, some journals call it as not editorial desk, editorial check they will call it as. And if they accept your paper in the sense, if they accept or they feel that your paper is following technical requirement, they will forward to the editor. Right? If the editor feels that their paper follows or carrying quality requirement, if editor is happy with your paper, he will forward to reviewers. Is it so? He'll forward to reviewers, and reviewers generally take actually 3 months time. Three months time. And after three months time, reviewers prepare the review. Minimum, there will be three reviewers. Elsevier journals, we have three reviewers, right? They are a blind reviewers. We call this blind reviewer, blind review process. Blind means you don't know the affinity or affiliation of reviewers. At the same time, reviewers, they don't know the affiliation of authors. That is called as blind peer review process, right? And reviewers may submit their review within 3 months' time. The review will be back to the editor. Looking at the review of all the preview people, the editor make actually a decision. It can be rejection, minor revision, or major revision. There are three sets of decisions he can make. For example, straight acceptance is a rare event, straight acceptance. There is 0% chance, straight acceptance. Major revision, you can say that around 1 to 2% chance in top journal. Rejection, 99% chance. Right? And it means that there is a high chance of rejection in top journals. High chance of rejection. And probably if I get a chance of major revision, I'll be lucky. That's what. The sole process, right? Is it so? It means that in a top journal, if I'm getting minor revision or major revision the first time, I can easily address. Most of the cases I can address. It means that your reviewers are happy with you, but they feel that your paper need to be improved. Paper need to be improved. Is it so? Paper need to be improved. And probably this process will go on around three rounds. And in the sense, you know, at the beginning itself, the reviewer feel that, or reviewers feel that, you know, the paper do not contain enough quality or satisfactory quality, now what they do, they reject your paper. If they reject the paper, you cannot submit the paper back again to the journal. You will not find a chance. But if they give a chance, you need to get the paper back. You need to address all these comments. You need to again submit back to the editor. So this process will go on if they are finding it very good, actually. If the reviewers feel that there is an opportunity, there is a scope, it'll give you minimum 3 to 4 rounds of review. And finally, if all the three reviewers accept, the editor will take a decision that your paper is accepted. That's what the process, right? Once the paper accepted, in most of the journals nowadays, there's a copy, the signing of copyright agreements, copyright. The copyright comes just after acceptance. In Elsevier nowadays, we have online copyright agreement form, online copyright. So we can sign the agreement online. So there is an accept option. They will send you a link. There is an accept option. You can accept your agreement terms and conditions. Immediately, automatically will be submitted. So once you sign the copyright, within 2 weeks time, they will send you the proof. Proof in the sense, you know, you will get chance to edit, do minor revisions. Minor editing in the sense, you know, you did major editing during your review process. If there are some changes in your spelling mistakes in your name or affiliation changes, some slight changes in your text, you can do in your proof reading time. Once you complete the proof reading, that is also online process. Within a week time, they will put your paper in online. They will put, you can see the paper in online, but the issue and volume will be assigned after some point in time. Now, when you accept your paper, an online version only carrying the DOI number, digital object identifying number, that's DOI. We call it a DOI number. It's a unique ID. The OLM and issue would be assigned after some point in time, right? So that is what the whole process of publishing, And if you look at the entire process and afterwards, as a researcher, what we need to do, and we need to make sure that our paper is getting more citations or better citations, because as an academic, as academician, we are always expecting better citation. That determines your reputation. Is it so? Is it so? So otherwise, we won't get any kind of monetary incentive. A great journal, a public good publication means after some point in time, you are getting citations. That's the way in which you are recognized, is it? And you need to make sure that you are getting enough number of citations so that your reputation, your authenticity in the domain is actually increasing day by day. Is it? Have you understood the point? So this is all about journal publication. I just want to summarize it, actually. Otherwise, generally, I'll conduct journal publication. I usually conduct workshops which contain around 1 week. Workshop for journal publications, right? So that is, if you look at the depth of this particular domain, it's so, you know, vast in nature, so that we can discuss a lot of things there. But ultimately, as a beginner, the discussion can be used as a, as actually, you know, beginning, so that you can identify your domain, identify the area, so that you can start reading. And you also understood what is corpus, what is Science Direct, what is Web of Science, what is JCR, what's the relevance of that, right? Is it so? As a beginner, this is sufficient. So is it fine? I mean, that's the reason I have a PPT also, but the problem is that if I show the PPT, I cannot cover everything. So minimum, I require 3 hours time. That's the reason. Extremely sorry for that. I just shared actually, so very summary about journal publication. So if you have any question, you can ask me so that I can address. Please ask, don't feel bad actually. So if you have anything, you can ask. Let me check the...
So there's a question in the chat box from Minu C again. Is there any workshop of yours that we can join?
Yes, I have a workshop, Ninu, and let me, Ninu, first thing would be, I'll tell you, UGC CARE, yes, we accept that, you know, UGC CARE, but the problem with UGC CARE is that every time UGC is changing the list of journals, right? And so that we don't, we are not able to, you know, stick to UGC CARE, because tomorrow, if you look at the UGC CARE listing, you can see some different set of journals, right? Is it so? So therefore, my suggestion to you is that you stick to a very authentic indexing service like Scopus and all, so that whenever you publish something in Scopus, surely that will be part of Scopus. Sorry, that definitely will be part of UGC CARE. Better to look at that strategy rather than looking at one journal in UGC CARE. After some point in time, you may find that journal is not there in UGC CARE. Strategies, look at a Scopus index journal. Definitely that journal will be there tomorrow in your UGC CARE. So that's what the best process of doing. Right. Yeah. Anything else?
Dear participants,
Minu, you are talking about SCI indexing, right? So SCI index means, I believe all of you saw Web of Science indexing, right? Web of Science, is it so? Web of Science is actually supported by an agency called as Thomson Reuters. And if you look at Web of Science, for social science journals, they are giving an indexing service. Scopus is an indexing, is it so? And Web of Science is giving an indexing for social science journals called as SSCI, Social Science Citation Index. SSCI. For science journals, giving an indexing called as Science Citation Index, called as SCI. SCI versus SSCI. SSCI is for Social Science Citation Index. That is for social science journal. SCI is for science journals.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
To the attention of all the participants, we have gone a long time. So I request you to mail the questions to us or directly to Sir Srijesh sir. So we'll be moving on. For the vote of thanks, I invite Dr. Arun Balakrishnan, Assistant Professor, Christ College, Irinyalakuda. Sir, please.
Dear participants, it was a great day in getting some information about research. So let me thank a few people who are so really interested in doing this program here. Professor, for all the participants, and I was so interested in this program here. Professor K.J. Joseph is our retired professor in our department in Christ College in Kerala. He was working in our department for around 34 long years. He was very dedicated and committed, and his major thrust areas were marketing, statistics, business statistics. We at Christ College always thrive and strive forward to provide good quality information with some of the best brains from the country. On that note, I would like to thank Dr. Srijesh for being with us this morning and delivering a really absolutely mind-blowing session on publications, journals, and all the information relating to indexing and all. So Dr. Srijesh, we thank you wholeheartedly from the department as well as from the college. Thank you so much. Definitely, we would like to have you in our college probably for a conference or a workshop once this corona fully comes down. So please come to our college when we invite you. So we'll be really happy to have you on. Then we have our principal, Dr. Reverend Dr. Jody Andrew CMI, for delivering the presidential address for this program. I thank you, Father. Then we have our dear HOD, Dr. Joshna Jose, who was the key person for arranging all these talks here. This is the last for all the participants. This is the last talk which you are arranging this year, organizing this year. This is the first and the last one for this academic year. So we will start the lecture series in the next year also. And it's a good end for this lecture series. So I thank Dr. Joshna Jose, head of the department, for being with us and directing us in conducting this webinar series. Then we have the program coordinator, Professor Shine Paul, for all the participants, and Dr. Srijesh. She's not available with us today. She's hospitalized. She has gone to meet the doctor. So she's not with us. So in her absence, I thank her for coordinating all these activities and arranging all the lecture series for this academic year. Thank you, Professor Shine. Then we have with us Professor Munish Murli, who delivered the welcome address. And I have with me in this studio, I have with me Professor Jibin, Professor Nilima, and I have Dr. Dong, Professor Rensen, and the person who anchored the program. This is Thomas, who is an MCOM student. I thank Thomas also for being with us. And last but not the least, all the participants. Still now, the participants were more than 100. Now it's exactly 101 or 103, something like that. Even after the program started, people are asking continuously, send us the link, send us the link, send us the link. It was just because people would have seen the brochure of Christ College and Dr. Srijesh's name there. So people are asking again and again. So we got stuck. We were sending, while the program also, we were sending the joining link to them, Zoom link to them, so that they won't miss out the valuable words from Dr. Srijesh. So once again, thank you all the participants. Many teachers were there, research scholars, PhD scholars, MPhil scholars were there, MCOM students were there. I thank all the participants. And once again, a very special thanks to Dr. Srijesh for being with us. Okay? Thank you, sir. Thank you so
thank
much.
You, thank you so thank much you. For your invitation.
And for all the participants.
For others, actually, I just shared the link of our programs and all. If you are interested, you can register and so that you can attend the programs. Thank you so much.
Yes.
If anything is there, please write back to me. And you can visit our webpage so that my contact details are there. So we'll address it.
Dear participants, please be free to contact us. Can contact Dr. Joshina Jose So we'll be giving the information about this webinar, and all the lecture series, if you have attended, we will be posting the PPTs and the PDFs which we have got from different resource persons. So thank you. Thank you all the participants. Thank you. Thank you, and have a nice day, guys.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to remind the participants that a feedback form has been posted in your chat box. Please make sure that you fill the feedback form. With that, we have come to the end of our lecture series. I hope you found these sessions helpful. May this lecture series provide a foundation for your research. We thank you for your support throughout the lecture. Take care, stay safe, and thank you once again. Thank you.